Rabbi syrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. Subhanaka la ilma lana illa ma 'allamtana innaka antal 'alimul hakim. Nawaitu ta'aluma wa ta'lima wa nafa'a wal intifa'a wa tadhakkura wa tadhkir wal ifada wal istifada wal hath 'ala tamassuki bi kitabillahi wa sunnati nabihi sallallahu alaihi wa sahbihi wasallam. Wa da'ata ila al-huda wa dilalati ila al-khair ibtigha'a wajhillahi wa qurbihi wa thawabihi amma ba'du. Alhamdulillah, my dear brothers and sisters, we continue our sessions in sharing advice about marriage, our new topic for this year. So when we talk about marriage, we are referring to the nikah, or the concept of nikah in Islam, which is something that we have to understand. When we talk about something in Islam, it is not simply a translation of the Arabic word in English. It is words in Arabic comes with nuances, comes with meanings that are beyond simply literal meanings. For example, when we talk about nikah, marriage is not just a union between two peoples. Whilst marriage and nikah share most meanings or similarities, but nikah in Islam carries something more sacred. It is more sacred and more significant because it involves our religion and it involves our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with our Creator. And there are other also significant differences in marriage between nikah or marriage in Islam or marriage for non-Muslims. For example, this long topic and discussion about the rights of wife and husband in Islam, where there is the notion that woman in Islam has no rights as wife and has to subject herself to the whims and the wants of the husband, while people may justify this with verses from the Quran and the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sometimes these things are taken from literal meanings without truly understanding the meanings and the context behind the words and verses. So that's why I always say, and I think for the whole of last year we have been saying in tafsir, that literal meanings does not necessarily mean what it seems to mean. So a verse in the Quran says that you can kill non-believers. If we are to take that at face value, then terrorism will be justified by Quran. And many other things, people use the literal meaning of the Quran. They simply take the translation of the Quran, and that is how people get funny ideas about what Islam is about and the practices of Islam. And so marriage is a lot of that. There's a lot of hadith, quite significant number of hadith by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying about the rights of husband and wife. This has to be understood in the context of living our lives as Muslims, as husband and wives, and people living in communities with our own families and roles and responsibilities towards each other. So by understanding this, and inshallah by things that we will share in this class, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it beneficial for our families and make it become knowledge that we can practice for ourselves, inshallah. So this is only the second week or the second lesson on this topic. We have shared last week an introduction into marriage in Islam and why. We also mentioned about the issue that a significant number, or rather the largest percentage of divorces per marriage every year is won or belongs to the Muslim community. Almost half the percentage. For example, one year there is around 4,000 to 5,000 marriages, Muslim marriages, solemnized every year. And in a year also, there is close to 2,000 final judgments, or rather 2,000 divorces being completed every year, almost 2,000. And marriage, 4,000 to 5,000. So that is almost 50%. So that means for every 2 walima, majlis kawin, jemputan, you go every weekend, 1 out of 2 or 1 out of 3 will end up in divorce in the multi-million dollar industry of jemputans. So a lot of money goes to waste when divorces happen. So not just that, there's only one repercussion of families breaking apart. There are a lot of other, inshallah, we'll continue. We will mention about this in the coming weeks. But unfortunately, the timings now, where Zohor is late, 1:20, we don't have much time, so we'll share what we can. Inshallah, the lessons will be longer once Zohor becomes earlier. A verse from the Quran serves as a reminder or mentions in brief our relationship as couples and our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah An-Nisa. As we said earlier, the rights of women in Islam. Sometimes it may seem that actually in Islam, women has more rights than men, in contrary to what people believe. For example, in the West, or for non-Malays, where people have surnames, we don't have surnames. So wives does not necessarily have to take the surname of the husband, because they don't, and keep their own family names, and their father's name remain. And in the Quran, there is no surah rajul, rijal. There is no surah by the name of the surah of men, but there is surah an-nisa. Nisa means woman. The woman have a whole surah just on their own. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the beginning, A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Ya ayyuhan nas, O men, dear men, ittaqu, not men, Ya ayyuhan nas meaning people at large, Ya ayyuhan nas, ittaqu rabbakumul ladhi khalaqakum, fear Allah, have taqwa in Allah, in your Lord, who created you, min nafsin wahida, from a single soul, wa khalaqa minha zawjaha, and from that Allah created its spouse or match, wa batha minhuma rijala, and also has spread forth from that couple rijalan kathiran wa nisa'a, men and women in vast quantities. Wattaqullah, and have taqwa in Allah, alladhi tasa'aluna bihi wal arham, in whose name you ask each other for your rights, and fear the violation of the rights of the womb relations. Inna Allah kana alaykum raqiba, surely Allah is watchful over you. While this verse, the name is woman, and also but the verse actually mentions about the responsibility of the husband, and the verse emphasizes by linking our responsibility with our faith, with our taqwa in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, making it the utmost priority. When Allah links something with our faith and iman, and Allah always mentions taqwa beside it, have taqwa, which means it is something that is of the utmost priority. For example, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said another thing. La yu'minu ahadukum hatta akuna ahabba ilayhi. This is about the love towards Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You do not believe until I become the most beloved to you, more than your love towards your child, your parents, and all mankind. Allah links the love of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to the completion of faith. The perfection of faith is linked to love of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, reminding us of the importance of that matter. So the same thing, Allah reminds us to have taqwa in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because people who do not hold on strongly to their religion feels that they have no responsibility to answer to Allah. So that is why they feel that they do not have responsibility, or they do not fulfill their obligations or responsibilities properly. So Allah is calling mankind, especially Muslims, you who say you are Muslim, you who believe in Allah, you who call yourself a Muslim, and Muslim means to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, submit to the rule of Allah, elevate and raise your iman, have taqwa in Allah, and ittaqullah, have taqwa in Allah, and take care of your family. Basically, that's what it means. Ittaqullah, ittaqu rabbakum, that Allah has created you from one spirit or from a single soul. And wattaqullah alladhi tasa'aluna bihi wal arham. You mention Allah, you use the name in a tafsir, it is mentioned what it means here, is that you use the name of Allah to ask for your rights. For example, people say, give me my dues for the sake of Allah. Or someone will say that, for example, one example that people commonly use nowadays is that in asking their rights of inheritance, there are some children of elderly parents who died, where at the whole of their parents' lives, once they graduated or got out of home and get married, they never returned to even look or say hi to their parents. And suddenly when their mother or father dies, that son suddenly appears and he cites the name of Allah. Allah says, I have a right over this inheritance. People use the name of Allah to ask for their rights. So this verse answers that by saying that الَّذِي تَسَأَلُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامِ. You use the name of Allah, you remember that Allah is looking over you. You remember that Allah looks at your actions. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلَيْكُمْ رَقِيبًا. Surely Allah is watchful over you. Surely Allah sees your every deeds and actions. Allah sees everything that you do not fulfill. Allah sees everything that you do not do. Allah sees everything that you do not complete and perfect. And you will be tasked and be responsible and answerable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that. While you use the name of Allah, remember that Allah will take you to task for it. So you use the name of Allah for that right, Allah will question you for it. So take care of your relations. الَّذِي تَسَأَلُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَمُ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ. Have taqwa in Allah. وَالْأَرْحَمُ. And fear the violation of the rights of the womb relations. That means, in a very general meaning, take care of your family. That is linked with taqwa to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is the spirit of the responsibility of a man towards his family, as was exemplified by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he said, khairukum khairukum li ahlihi, the best of you are the best towards his family. The best amongst you, khairukum, the best amongst you, khairukum li ahlihi, is the one who is the best towards his family. Wa ana khairukum li ahli. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I am the best towards my family. Because why did he say that he is the best towards his family? Because we use Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as our example. He is our qudwa, he is our uswa, he is our example that we follow. People claim they are good Muslims, they don't leave their 5 prayers a day. They go Hajj every year, they go Umrah every week. And they claim to follow Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but they do not, or they are not kind towards their family, then Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is alluding to you that you still are not the best Muslim, as khairukum wa ana khairukum li ahli, and amongst you I am the best towards my family. So if you claim to follow the sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you claim by the name of Allah your rights, and for your wife to respect you and to obey you and to fulfill her obligations as a wife, you use the name of Islam, and our perfection of our faith is to follow truthfully the sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So that means also, in addition to the acts of worship that we do, or for some of us the length of our beards or the length of our jubahs or pants, our kindness and how we treat our wives has also to be in the best manner possible, like how Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us. He did not beat his wife, he did not lay his hand on any one of his wives, and he only got angry when the rulings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are compromised. Not a wife not fulfilling her duties, he does not angry with that. He does not get angry with that. For example, there was a time, a day, when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came out and asked his wife, "Do we have anything to eat?" Sayyidatina Aisha radiallahu anha answered, "We do not have anything to eat." If we were in that position and you wake up hungry and there is nothing to eat, all kinds of hadith or verses from the Quran, if you are a learned person, will come out to justify that you are doing something wrong. But when we look at Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did not even once say that as a wife, "You know, you have to do what? You have to do this and this and this." But no, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Okay, so there is no food, then I will fast for today." Look at the akhlaq of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He is in the same time being thankful and a dutiful servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at the same time how he treats his wife with utmost kindness, perseverance and understanding of their situation. And that is what we can also mean by saying have taqwa in Allah towards our woman and also towards our families. Have taqwa in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over that. Of course, besides that is to make sure that we provide for their daily needs, give their nafaka, and also to provide shelter for them. All of that is also part of our taqwa in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is the spirit behind the roles and responsibilities of both husband and wife. And that is only one aspect of marriage, and the others we will continue and touch on it inshallah. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, An-nikahu sunnati. This is part of a longer hadith. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, An-nikahu sunnati. Marriage is a part of my sunnah, of my practice. And he who dislikes my practice is not from me. So this again, we link, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam links marriage to his sunnah, and non-compliance or not wanting to be in marriage as not wanting to follow the sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Of course, it is something that is sunnah and there is no compulsion. So I will touch on one thing first before we go into this. In Islam, there are five rulings on certain things, on things. There is wajib, compulsory. There is sunnah, encouraged. There is mubah, allowed. There is makruh, discouraged. And there is haram, which is prohibited or forbidden. So the nikah can fall into all five of these categories. When we say that not wanting to get married is not a sunnah, or not wanting to complete the sunnah, that is when you are in the position of nikah not being wajib or nikah not being haram. For example, nikah can be wajib. When is nikah wajib for someone? When is nikah compulsory for someone? Is that when someone who has a strong desire or shahwa or nafsu. He can't control himself. He can't control his sexual desires. He can't focus on everything. And he already has the capability to get married. He has the means to pay. And he is an adult, but he has problem with not fulfilling his sexual desire. And then nikah becomes compulsory for him. Because if he cannot, he does not go into nikah, he will fall into sin on a daily basis. So that nikah is to protect his religion. This is one thing, it's not everything. Because this is just one example, I'm saying. It's not, does not mean that nikah primarily serves to fulfill or gratify your sexual desires, but this is just one example. Because for certain people, people are there, there are different types and different levels of people. People have different backgrounds, people have different needs. There are people who does not care whether his sexual desire is gratified or not. There are people who has a high level of sexual desire where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that people are different. Allah created people different kinds and levels and types. And so for one people, this ruling can be wajib. For one people, ruling can be sunnah and everything else. But for most people, I mentioned about the wajib compulsory part, I mentioned about the forbidden part. How can nikah be haram for someone? For example, when someone who is known to be abusive, for someone who is known to have, cannot be in close proximity with other people who will spread diseases, or someone who is, basically, for someone who, when he gets married, the wife will be someone who will be abused and harm is most likely will be inflicted upon her, then nikah for that guy will be haram until he learns to sort himself out. That is, nikah can be haram for someone. But for most people who are not already married, then nikah is sunnah for him. And this is what is mentioned here. Marriage is part of my practice, and he who dislikes my practice is not from me. And so, this is for first marriage. For polygamy, this is whole another issue where we will talk maybe after this topic of marriage or at the end of it. So, what is the ruling of polygamy? People say it is sunnah, but when we look through the lenses of fiqh or sharia Islam, it's not every time it's a sunnah. So for someone who can barely afford to maintain his marriage and his 5 kids, and he suddenly wants the urge that he says, I want to marry another one, and say it is sunnah. No, we have to look properly at his situation and through the lenses of sharia, through the lenses of fiqh. As I said, for the first timers, nikah can be wajib or sunnah or mubah or makruh or haram. The same thing for those ones who are into second marriage. Nikah can be haram if it is highly probable that by marrying another one, he will harm his first wife and any other things that will be inflicted upon the first wife. So before one goes into marriage, so when we talk about this, we see the spirit behind the rules and the regulations of sunnah, of marriage. It's not something to give leverage to any other sex or give leverage to anyone to abuse over other, but it serves as a guideline, as a traffic light to guide people going to their destination in a proper manner, in a safe way, and basically to live happily ever after in this life and also in the hereafter. Inshallah, we will continue. So much to share. We will continue in the following weeks, because it is very important that this topic. Sorry, I didn't. Okay. It is a big topic really in Islamic studies, because the nikah, marriage, a family. Family rules, family fiqh, the jurisprudence of Islam is mainly divided into 4 divisions. Ibadat, mu'amalat, ahwal shakhsiyah, and jinayat. Relating to our acts of worship, relating to our transactions, relating to ahwal shakhsiyah, matters relating to the family. So this is 1/3 of fiqh. One fourth of fiqh, which means that it is a really big thing. But so many people nowadays go into marriage without this information. So it shows that how we are lacking in the information relating to marriage. And inshallah, hopefully by the sharing, we will give some benefit to all who are willing to be present in our classes. Thank you for your time. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah al-azim li wa lakum. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilaik. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.